And next up, we have Kasia Modrzyńska from the University of Glasgow, talking about transcription factors.
Okay. So thank you very much, Suhab. And my name is Katarzyna. I'm from Glasgow, from Wellcome Centre of Integrative Parasitology. And I wanted to thank the organizers for letting me come here and inviting me to give a talk. And as was mentioned, I'm interested in transcription regulation in Plasmodium. So as we all know, the life cycle of Plasmodium is a pretty complex affair involving multiple different cell types, each of them with very different morphology and metabolism. And it's all generated using a very compact genome containing just 5,000 genes. It's actually a bit smaller than the one that is contained in the laboratory yeast, which obviously have much less of a diversity. Therefore, unsurprisingly, the parasite needs to change the expression level of majority of its genes all the time. In fact, if you look at each life stage transitions accompanied by a complete gene expression overhaul, if you look at every single gene, it's different between the life stages, often reaching one distinctive peak, which create this pretty waterfall images that I think we're all familiar with. And the existence of these patterns implies that this process needs to be very precisely regulated and can be potential source of either the drug targets or the strategies to control and regulate the parasite. Yet we know very little about the molecular basis of it. More specifically, when it comes to the regulator of gene expression, we know that it happens mostly at the level of a gene promoter. However, when it comes to the factors that would bind to it, the Plasmodium genome contains very few proteins with any nucleic acid sequence-specific binding potential. Here you have sort of a snapshot of all of them. And you can really see that there are really two major groups only. One of them is the IPAP transcription factors, that are the only family of transcription factors identified in the only major family of transcription factors identified in Plasmodium so far. And the other one are zinc finger proteins, which are a very generic group that sometimes can be connected with a gene expression regulation, which I'm not going to talk about them today, but ask me if you want to know more about them. So in my lab, we're trying to understand how this process works with this limited number of factors, using as a model one particular transition from the gametocyte to okinets. It's a very biologically relevant process. As you can see, it's a major bottleneck of a Plasmodium life cycle. And it's also one of the biggest changes in the Plasmodium cycle when the cell needs to change the host, the motility status, shape, metabolism, pretty much everything. So initially we started by just generating the gene expression profile from different time points of this transition that were at that time not available. And this is the time course through the time of expression of all the different expressed genes through the kind of development. So as you see, there are really a lot of happenings there. We observe the significant changes already 2 hours post fertilization. And when we look at some model genes that we know are highly expressed in the beginning of this process, but no longer present here in the mature okinets or the reverse, we could see this nice gradual transition from gametocyte genes that would be gradual decrease and the okinet specific genes like chitinase onward that would be gradually increased. And in total, we have pretty much half of a parasite genes over 2000 that would be significantly expressed at least between one of those track clusters. We also wanted to check whether these changes we observed, in fact, due to the slow changes in the gene expression, as in just the variation within our cell population and just different stage composition. So we repeated it using single cell sequencing, when we use just a mixture of cultures from different time points in order to generate the transcriptomes of a single cell. And in fact, I don't want to enter into the details of the data as we're still looking for some things in it, but you can clearly see that you have one starting and one ending point of sort of developmental trajectory. And again, you see the same gametocyte specific genes being present mostly in that left-hand cluster and sort of gradually decreasing. And the okinet-specific gene, again, starting low enriching the peak of its expression in that later cluster. And in fact, the both classical gamete cytokine genes have been de novo identified as markers. So knowing that we in fact have these gradual changes, we look at the with the Kiroshika clustering to identify the groups of co-regulated genes. And we could identify around 8 clusters of differentially expressed genes. And within each of them, we have genes that were functionally connected. For example, you can see here the crystalloid connected genes decreasing. You can see here the enter to host, which are important for kinetic penetration being in a cluster that is gradually increasing. And what was really important, we also identified the different DNA motifs that were significantly enriched in the promoters of all of those clusters, suggesting that in fact we do have some molecules that are binding and regulating it on a sequence level. In order to see if this happened on a DNA or RNA level, we generated also a time course of a chromatin conformation at the different stages of a kind of differentiation. So this is a protocol called ATAC-seq, which allows to identify the chromatin regions that are open and therefore very likely to bind something like transcription factors on enhancer or something like that. And the interesting genomes, so interesting regions, are being visualized at those peaks of increased coverage. So if you just look at the raw data, you can see that you have some differences between the profiles at different time points. And all of them are very different from the one that was generated in a sexual parasite. So we tried to match it a little bit to the genes. And in a lot of cases, it looked fine. You can see a lot of peaks that were in front of the genes that have been specific to gametocyte and decreasing, but would gradually go down. And the peaks for all kinds of specific genes that would gradually increase. However, while the changes in the transcript expression were very gradual, the change in the ATAC-seq profile appeared to be very sudden. It actually happens within the first 2-3 hours after the cell fertilization. If you look at the similarity of the global profiles using this PCA visualization of cervical Jakart index, you could see here, you start with the early zygotes, you move it to the early or kind of developing, and then you have this very big shift, and this profile pretty much remains constant for the next 24 hours without much changes. So that was interesting, and it was not really matching the transcriptome observed, but definitely suggested at the DNA level we have something binding there. So in terms of what it could be, we return to our inventory of potential transcription factors, and we look again at the APAP2 family. And in fact, there were 7 members of this family that were expressed during the kinet stage. We have proteomic evidence that they're actually there. So we created this mini screen tagging all of them. In fact, for majority of them, we could detect expression, usually nuclear. And 4 of them were present at the very start of a kind of development at the early zygotes. And 4 of them were present at the very end. Each of them had a very slight different expression profile. But given also that AIFAs are sometimes not very reliable, we tend not to give them an exact hour and starting points. But what was really encouraging out of the genes we look at, 5 of them have been previously identified either by me or by other groups as essential for the all-kinet development. We, all of them, the moment that you remove them from the parasite, result in a cells that cannot develop or develop into very abnormal shape, and none of those parasites could be transmissible. And all of them were characterized by a really, really divergent gene expression profile. So wanted to see if we can map the occupancy on those factors in the genome. And we succeeded with map 4 of those. And 2 of them expressed early during the development, 2 of them expressed late in the development. Characteristics were the only factors out of that set that we look, that we could say that all of them were uniformly nuclear. That allow us to look for each of those factors, call the number of high confidence peak, look how they are positioned within genome. And as a rule, they were almost exclusively positioned upstream of the nearest transcription start site within the first 500 base pair, which was kind of something that you would expect when it comes to the regulatory proteins. Within each of those, we could also identify the motif preferentially on reach within the peaks of those peaks. And again, very nicely, these motifs were either corresponding to the motifs that was previously identified either in vitro or in vivo as a binding motif for one of those factors, or in case of those early one, as a motif that was previously described in a number of publications as called de novo and important for the early zygote gametocyte development. We also returned to see how it matched our ataxic data, as we were expecting that those factors would bind something. And the overlap, in fact, was very good. So we could actually see that we, for pretty much both like locally, as you can see from the set of traces, but also globally, if you just select peak from one of those transcription factors, you can see that they almost always have a coverage of that looks similar in the other transcription factor and in ataxic. And they are almost completely clean in the input. So one thing that suggested that those factors are very often, if not always, binding together. Second thing that it suggested is that a lot of ataxic peaks, if not all of them, and the ones that could be explained as the presence of those two factors. So while it's possible that there's something else binding there, it seems that all the major occupancy sites are being factored just using looking at those two. And same thing happened with the two late factors. It's maybe less clean, especially because AP204 peak calling was a bit complicated, but slightly lower data quality. But again, we could see that there's a reasonably good overlap between two transcription factors and the ataxic. And again, we could identify no like major groups of the ataxic peak that were not accounted for. We also tried to see in that case, assume we kind of take an assumption that each peak is connected to the regulation of its nearest gene, which given the density of plasmodium genome might not be true in every single case. But essentially globally, we could see that the genes that were likely to be targets of those factors were actually, like for the two early ones, expressed mostly in the gametocyte stage, or the late one expressed mostly in the okinate stage. We could also use our gene expression data to narrow things down between those two extremes. And again, we could see this gradual decrease. In fact, some of them overlap very nicely with the cluster we called. So that was really interesting. And we started to look, you know, is this gradual changes connected to the fact that we have either more and more factor binding or the factors start binding different and different genes? So we look if whether the occupancy of those factors is changing at all within the or kind of development. So we've done it for two of them, but I just want to show you one. It's this one is the one that is the most abandoned and has been historically probably the most studied APP2 because it's been the first one identified. And this one called AP2O, there's this expression profile that is at first we could identify and chip it as early as 4 hours post-fertilization. And it pretty much remains there throughout the kind of development. As you can see, there's a very little difference between those profiles, which made us think at the time, okay, so maybe each transcription factor has its own set of foci in the genome when it can go. But there's one particular thing about that one that actually was not in my head for a long, long time. This factor had another very small peak of expression. While if you look normally, it's just a kind of specific gene, it has also a shade of expression in plasmodium schizons. And that's been confirmed both in the various bulks RNA-seq data set, but also in a single cell data set, which could not be explained by any additional contamination from other stages. You could definitely see a little bit of this expression, which made, again, which started to interest us wherever we can do anything in a sexual stage is a risk factor. So one thing with a lot of work, we could actually see it. And while it was very, very faint and borderline invisible, we could see a little shape suggesting that it's not only transcript, but it's also the protein that is there. Now, another interesting thing about it is that in various screens that's been done either by me or globally by other teams, this particular factor has shown that it's knockout as a growth defect. You have here the phenotype in the sexual stages of all the different APP2 transcription factors. And as you see, a lot of them here in green grow normally. Some of them here are pretty much lethal, as far as it cannot replicate. But there a group of them that is characterized as slow growers. And AP2O was definitely one of them. So I thought, okay, it seems that it's there as a transcript and protein is functional. So can we actually check if its occupancy, even if it's so low expressed? So after a couple of tries, it did work. And we could see that we did have an expression profile also in schizons, which as you can see is quite different than the one that we were observing the kinet development. In fact, there's very little overlap between those peaks. What was, however, interesting, if you do the de novo motif calling, it binds to the exactly same motifs in the schizons and in the kinet. It just this motif is being situated in different places. And in fact, if you look at what is it, that big peak is just in front of the AMA1 gene, which for those who are probably know is a very schizon specific gene, nothing to do with all kinets and not what you'd expect as a target of AP2O. And in fact, if you look globally at the predicted targets, we see all the big schizon genes that are being bound by that gene. And the GOTAMs that are being also very specific for the general merozoid schizon proton. And in fact, if we look at the peaks and the genes that they are being bound to, we could see that the ones that were called only in our kinets as a position of the genome were in front of the genes that were expressed pretty much exclusively in our kinets. The ones that were bound only in schizons were positioned in front of the schizon-specific genes. The one and there were a couple of them that were bound by AP2O, both in schizon and in kinet, were actually in front of the genes that show this expression profile. It's actually not similar to the expression profile of AP2O itself, and had this small increase in schizons, but really huge increase of transcription in all kinets, suggesting that, yeah, this gene universally works as activator. So that was at the time very unexpected, as first of all, yeah, it was characterized by few groups as very much all kind of specific gene. And secondly, because we thought that we know what is the key player in schizon. It has been identified by Manuel Lina's group, and that gene was called AP2I. And that was identified in plasmodium falciparum. So we're thinking, would the two parasites be very different? So we actually got contacted by Gerhard Vanderlich from São Paulo, who at the time happened to have a GFP-tagged plasmodium falciparum AP2O parasite, which gave us a unique position to actually compare the parasites from the two different species, but the same stage. So we also tried to perform a ChIP-seq on AP2O in that parasite, which again, Gerhard showed that it's being expressed on a very, very low level. And essentially we saw the same thing, a strong binding of genes that were very much characterized as merozoid specific, the MSP family, AMA1, GAP45, et cetera. And again, it was always bound to the same motif that appeared to be very conserved. Now, when we tried to compare the expression profiles between different parasites, which was not easy because particularly around the merozoid stage, you know, they have a lot of species-specific genes, you could see that, here again, it's a matrix of PCA to see how similar they are. You see, have on component one, you have a very strong species specific component with Falciparum and Berger clustering apart. However, in a component two, you see that, yes, the two factors that I was talking about, the early ones of free FGR clustering together, the other two in our kinets, AP204 and AP20 in our kinets also clustering together. But when you look at AP20 in the schizons, it's sort of apart from all the kinet profiles. And it's very similar on that component to the profile of the plasmodium falciparum. And in fact, many single genes would be connected to it. So the next thing I wanted to think about was what this gene actually can be doing functionally. Because we know that it binds a schizon-specific gene. We know it's not really needed there because the parasite can grow without it, although a bit slower. And that made me think, you know, it might have a modulator role. So I started to query various data sets where we can see the differences expression of AP2O in the different things. So we found one in a paper that has been produced by Marion Motalab that dealt with a reaction plasmodium out of plasmodium to the host diet. Marion and her team have shown that if you put animals on a diet restriction, a calorie restriction diet, yes, compared to the mouse that can eat as much as they want, the parasite in these animals are growing slower, sort of adapting to their host state. And that was caused by the fact that in these conditions, the parasite in the calorie restricted animals were producing less merozoids than a parasite in a normal animals. And at the time, I collaborated with Maria to produce some gene expression profile of those parasites. And in fact, one of the genes that was validated, I think it takes a moment to catch up with me. You need to trust me, I guess, that one of the genes that shows a very strong expression between the ad limitum and calorie restriction diet was in fact AP2O. So could the AP2O be involved in the diet restriction? So maybe I can do this. Oh, that works. So together with Maria, we decided to test that hypothesis and check if the AP2O parasite is able to respond to the nutrient depletion. And again, as you can see, I'm not sure why it does it. Yeah. I have genuinely no idea what's happening here. It actually looks fine on my screen. I think you just need to try to trust me that you have a wild-type parasite that here is a control in the FBS serum. This is the normal diet, this calorie-restricted diet. The parasite produces significantly less schizons. Now I'm curious what will happen myself. Okay, I may try to go back and, back and forth. Oh, okay. Fair time lucky. So, and instead, the AP2O parasite actually don't show the significantly different changes in the number of merozoid per size in a similar diet. In fact, when you look how they grow, it seems that they always produce the number of merozoids that is more characteristic for the calorie-restricted diet than the one that, to fed animals, fully fed animals, I guess. Which was really interesting as identify AP2O as a very specific factor involved in two very different processes. On one hand, acting as a very housekeeping transcription factor dealing with a big stage transition as one of the major orchestrators. On the other hand, having this kind of moonlighting role as a nutrient sensor in the asexual stages and doing it all by binding the same six base pairs motif that has been previously identified. So taken all together, this various areas of investigation has kind of taught me this new thing. So this is sort of the way I see the position and role of transcription factors. Now it's probably going to change tomorrow because a lot of people are doing a lot of great work on them. So things that we know is to finish, the transcription factors are binding in groups. And it seems that this quasi-cooperative binding is required for promoter activation, because if you remove any of those, that transitions are no longer happening. The transcription factor binding sites correspond to, or possibly might be driven by, the chromatin availability, as the match is really good. And importantly, the transcription factors in plasmodium are very versatile, and they change their occupancy through the genome and even general function according to the life stage and environment. And I think I'm looking forward to investigate a little more about how all those factors are interacting with each other. So at the end, I just wanted to help everybody contributing to that work, particularly Rachel and Isabel, who have generated most of the next generation sequencing data and parasite lines that I was talking about, Kirsten, who's done most of the analysis, but also the rest of the gang as well, multiple master students that have been absolutely great passing through the lab. The great facility, the Welcome Center, and the people there who've been absolutely instrumental in making things work in my new lab. But also the collaborators, particularly Gerhard for the gift of AP2O tag parasite, Maria for help of a diet destruction experiment, and other teams in Glasgow, particularly Andy Waters' team, when Sebastian Kutcher helped with the establishment of a TAC-seq, and Marty team and Francisca, who's been very helpful in getting the single cell sequencing, and of course, my funders. And thank you, all of you, for bearing with me and listening. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
So that was awesome. That was really nice. If you look at the AP2s that bind in pairs,
yeah.
If you look at the sites that are only singly bound, and you look at the expression changes, do you need both of them to bind? Or if you don't, is it additive? Is it synergistic?
Yeah. So one thing we know is that you definitely need both of them, because if you remove just one, that transition is not happening. Oh, another thing but, we know is you
at the single gene level.
Yeah.
At the single gene level.
Yeah. So at the single gene level, the problem is that the steady state transcriptome of all of those parasites is all over the place, because it's not that it's being just blocked in the development. It seems to go completely aberrant way. So it's really hard to tell whether there's a section of genes that are up and down regulated, or it's everything. What we do know is that the absence of one does not seem to affect the expression of the other. But that's a very careful statement, because it's some data that we need to repeat to make sure. But it seems that absence of the one might be affecting the ability of another one to bind in the right places. But we don't know if it works in all combinations and couples.
And in wild type parasites, the loci where only one is binding, but not the other, does that still lead to the upregulation of those?
Sorry, is there?
So the overlap isn't perfect, right? You also have some loci where only one of the pairs is bound. And so are the loci where only one is bound, do they get upregulated or do they not get upregulated?
Actually, a few loci that I was very, very sure that one of them binds and the other one not, were actually the loci that were very intragenic, that they're just like in the middle of a gene. Mm-hmm. And I don't, so it might be that either they bind there in collaboration of something else, mm-hmm. or it might be that there is some additional level of regulation that happens within the gene body that one of them is involved in. But yeah, it's something that we need to look. It's probably a good idea to look at it a bit more.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I was wondering if you can tell us a bit more about the axis of caloric restriction, the kinase, kin, and AP2O, how they interplay to regulate the number of daughter cells.
So how AP2O regulates the number of merozoites?
Well, there's Maria showed that there's the kinase involved, yeah. Right? The kin, and I was wondering how they work together to regulate the number of daughter
cells. So it's true that Mario Motta identified another gene, a kinase, that has similar-ish phenotype, but also does not react to the diet change. We At the moment, we don't know how those genes are working together. What we do know is that AP2O does not affect the expression of a kinase. What we don't know is whether the kinase may or may not phosphorylate the transcription factor, for example.
So, but if I understand you correctly, that may mean that there are two parallel pathways?
I think we don't know enough to really tell it. It's possible that those things are acting independently to produce the phenotype we are observing in calorie restriction. It's possible that they're part of the same pathway that we haven't properly dissected yet. It's possible, for example, that the kinase is phosphorylating a transcription factor. We haven't looked for it and we haven't tested that.
And if I may ask another question, if I recall correctly, then it was AMA1 mainly you found to be downstream of AP2O, right?
Yeah.
In the Schei zone. But then again, like how is AMA1 expression lead to different number of merozoites?
So I think what happens is that possibly the number of merozoites, that's pure speculation. I don't have any data to back it up.
Yeah.
What might happen is that the number of total transcript produced, which you know would be boosted by presence of AP2O, that would be the additional factor binding to the promoter, might translate the total number of available proteins that somehow might in turn translate, you know, to the number of merozoites that ultimately will be produced. What we did not find, and I was looking for it, we did not find AP2O specifically regulate any major group of things connected with like a DNA replication. You would think maybe that would act in that level. But again, we don't know really if this is a full pathway that we're sampling or there's some more things going on.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
An active mechanism of recruiting towards those specific regions via different factors, or if it also could be a restriction of accessibility by nucleosomes or...
Yeah, so we currently, as I said, give me 2 weeks, because we're looking at some data that would relate to it. What we don't know at the moment is like chicken or egg, wherever the chromatin changes are driven by transcription factors that are binding there, or wherever they are making some regions accessible to transcription factors.
Yeah.
I mean, there's this one experiment generated by a Japanese group, Soyuda, that suggested that actually might be the latter. It shows that when you try to bind the transcription factor of AP2 family, not this one, but another one, you actually get quite a lot of binding. And if it's a pure DNA, it seems to be bind almost every single motif. So it might be that it's a chromatin accessibility that restricts, you know, where it can go.
Yeah, and I guess there is no MNase data in all kinetes available yet, right?
But I think the ATAC-seq data is a good proxy for that. And so what we analyzing now is a set of the ATAC-seq experiments performed on those knockouts to see essentially if you remove a transcription factor, do you see the change in the chromatin profile? So yeah.
Ask
me in a few weeks.
Right, we'll finish it. Thank you very much.